The topic is the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, and the guest is Alana McLaughlin, and she's given us some information relative to the end of the institution of slavery with the passage of the 13th, 14th, and the 15th Amendments to the Constitution of the United States, and she's now dealing with the National Association of Advancement for Colored People in a way that will lead her up to the civil rights movement of the 1960s. Now, let's talk about that civil rights movement of the 1960s, because I think the most important person that you're generally familiar with is Dr. Martin Luther King. Let's talk about him within the context of the movement to deal with the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendment.
Well, in Martin's childhood, he had one friend who was white, and their father told them that they wouldn't play anymore because they were white and he was black. That really struck a kind of a deep hole in Martin's life, a hole that couldn't be filled, because he dearly was playmates with that friend, but only to be pushed away by a thing called segregation. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't think that was unfair. If my friend was, I have Filipino friends, I have Mexican, Indian, Spanish, I have friends from everywhere. And I would feel that it would be right for me not to be their friend because I'm not the same. I don't originate from where they originate. So I wouldn't think that would be fair, and neither should Martin have to put up with something that cruel.
And so that was part of the information that you know about Dr. King, that he had that impact, had an impact on his whole upbringing in terms of his attitudes about he gave this great speech called I Have a Dream at one time. What was that all about?
Well, one night, Martin had a dream, and he said that the dream said that we would all live in peace and that we would all just love each other and hug each other, and we would all be friends. Now, him and his wife, Coretta Scott King, they march, and they go around the world talking of this dream, they say. And they say that it was of peace and everybody loving each other and just everybody being friends and just no hatred in the whole world.
Well, now, does it sound strange to you that a person like Dr. Martin Luther King, who had such a dream, should be killed by somebody? Why don't you say something about his assassination?
Well, one day he was in his Memphis hotel in Boehm. There was a gunshot. Nobody knew what was happening, so everybody went up, and then they saw Martin Luther King in a pool of blood on the balcony of his Memphis hotel.
And at the Lorraine Hotel in Memphis, Tennessee. And
that really struck a hole in his wife Coretta Scott King's life. That really struck a hole in her life. And she, I believe she never got remarried. I believe that really kind of caused a kind of a hole in her life because she deeply loved Martin. And I'm sure I would be deeply struck if my husband was assassinated because he was standing up for what he believed in.
And so I Have a Dream speech has had an impact upon you as well as some of your peers. Do you know anybody else who has the same understanding of the I Have a Dream speech of Dr. Martin Luther King?
There may be a lot of people who feel as I feel, but not as many youth as there should be. As you grow up, you can get more of a better understanding of Dr. King and of how he lived his life, and you could get a better understanding. Now, I'm nine, I have a very great understanding, and I could teach anybody about him, but I think more youth should learn about Dr. King, and more adults should also.
And not only, I think one time you came to us on and you dealt with the sesquicentennial of the Civil War, in which you talked about the importance of us. So you would put the Civil War and the Civil Rights Movement together as something that people ought to know about.
Yes.
How would you tie those two events together?
Well, they were both fought with whites and blacks. Now, the Civil Rights Movement, it was saying that the white people were against the black people. And in the Civil War, the people, they all wanted to be together, but the white people, they couldn't stand that. So they fought to try to kill as many black people or free men as they could.
And of course, all of that violence and everything simply led to freedom for the Africans in the 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments, and the establishment of the NAACP.
Yes.
How do you think Dr. King felt about the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People?
I think Dr. King would be very proud of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, because they were stating everything that Martin Luther King dreamed of, everything that he hoped of, everything that he had a dream about. All the things that were in his dream were just scooped up and placed into the hands of the NAACP.
And so in a real sense, the NAACP is carrying on the tradition of Dr. Martin Luther King, and the tradition of not only Africans, but the tradition of blacks and whites working together. I understand that was one of the strange things about this NAACP organization. Why don't you say something about the interracial relationships at this organization?
Well, the NAACP started out with 32 people. And you may not know this, but some of those people were actually white men. There was one man named Henry who was born in 1836. He basically stated that he was one of the CEOs of the NAACP, and yes, he was white, because he thought that slavery and that wasn't really fair to anybody, because I'm sure that no white person would want to be slaves and be owned by a black person, because they would feel as if they didn't have to do that. And if it turned on the white people, then they would see how the black people put up with all that, and they would see how the black people felt.
And so there's a lesson in terms of trying to work together and to work against separation and segregation. And you would always be in favor of working against separation and segregation. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, I would.
You believe the equality of everybody, is it men, women, races, and et cetera. Is that the position that you're taking now talking to me here?
Yes, it is.
Speak to that then. I mean, do you think that that's a godly kind of position, or that's what God would have us to do?
I think God is very proud of what all those people stood up for, like for Coretta Scott King, Rosa Parks, Sojourner Truth, Harriet Tubman, MLK, Malcolm X. He would be proud of them, because they stood up for what they believed in, and they stood up for their 13th, 14th, and 15th Amendments.
And so there's a long train of individuals that go way back into the history of the United States of America that opposed slavery, you believe. And I think you've indicated that on a number of occasions, talking about some of the abolitionists and Sojourner Truth and other individuals. And so these individuals all opposed slavery, and they all favored the NAACP, and you believe that the NAACP, even though it was established in 1909, is still an organization that young people like yourself ought to support. Why should they support such an organization?
Because the NAACP wanted to give black people what they deserve, and they wanted to give them the rights that every black person dreamed of. Not just Martin Luther King had a dream, but all black people had a dream of being treated equally one day, and being the same as a white person would have been treated.
Making some closing statements in reference to that, you believe that more people should be more concerned about the topics that we are talking about here today, and that your age ought to be especially concerned about it. Why should they be concerned about it?
Because it's a part of their heritage. Now, they can learn about the Civil War, and it may not be a part of their heritage, but it's still a part of history, and all black people should learn about the people who tormented them and the people who stood up for them. They should all learn about it, because I feel they believe to know the truth.
Okay, and very good. And I thank that you for that kind of information today, Lana. And I believe that in a real sense, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People can live and continue to do the things that it has already done. And I just want to thank you for bringing that information by. And I want to encourage our audience to tune in again next week for another informative edition of Comments. Thank you, and
good morning.